Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 9 of the To A Degree podcast. This episode is preparing for work, so we're going to be discussing all the things that we think we did that helped us get to the apprenticeship that we're under today. So we'll go around and introduce ourselves one by one. I'm Charlie Harrison. I'm a software engineering apprentice.
I'm Jonathan Reflex. I'm a manufacturing engineering apprentice.
I'm Jasmine, and I'm an electrical apprentice.
I am Sam, and I'm an electrical engineering degree apprentice in my first year.
Hi, I'm Joe, and I'm an electrical engineering apprentice, and I've had a haircut. That's why I look so different.
So to begin with, we want to discuss some of the things that we think we were taught by some of our better teachers. So any practical skills that helped us. I know definitely I had a really good physics teacher just to start off with, a teacher called Joseph Brock, and he was a really good teacher at being able to make you do your own research. I know that might sound like a given, a bit of a takeaway, but it's a really fine line between a teacher leaving you high and dry with no support and saying, you've got to work it out for yourself. And I mean, there's a fine line again between that becoming just being spoon-fed information, here's the answers, memorize it for the test.
When I went to college, I was working, I went to a UTC, which is like a specific type of college for people who want to go into construction engineering and design. And that was a really good environment in general, because most of my teachers were people who had been working in the industry. You know, they weren't just people who had gone and got their degree and then went straight back into teaching, which I found was often the case when I was in secondary school. But in college, because all my teachers had worked in the industry, so they, you know, of course, that was great to be in that sort of environment where almost effortlessly they were teaching us about the working environment.
Often it'll be the teachers with that industrial experience in the field somewhere that actually you start to notice that they've got a different approach to things that is actually, I find, more helpful. And it's nothing saying you can't have that ability without doing industry experience, but I think it's something that I've even noticed within my lectures, the difference between the teachers. And their practical skills are so much more diversified, and you can just tell. I've mentioned it in other podcasts. I mentioned it all the time. I love mentioning it. But outside of school, I did air cadets. And I think that contributed largely to just generally who I am today, as well as specifically the apprenticeship. And I think it weighs up a lot of things that I've managed to achieve. But at school, personally, I was involved in the school council, not big on sports teams or any of the other clubs. But anyone else got any maybe more obscure clubs they were part of at school?
Football team. I captained the football team for like 3 of the 5 years I was in it. And that brings, well, it's not really that much responsibility in middle school football, but you know, you think you have responsibility, and it definitely improved my communication skills. I did seriously like take on the role of captain, and I did make sure that my team was, you know, sorting themselves out and whatever. So it did actually help me, even though it's not really that big of a big of a thing to brag about.
You say that you're like you're playing it down, but it's definitely, I think it surely has to be said, it's exposing you to something that, it's just otherwise, even on whatever scale it is, you're still being exposed to that responsibility, and yeah, just forces you to think about things. I don't know. Of course, I'm not an expert on this. I'm a software engineer, so famously we're quite out of touch with these situations. But from my experience, the few times you get put in them situations, you do come out as like a different person. You start to become more self-aware.
More than anything, it did wonders for my interview stages, because as you've just done, you've bigged it up. But in an interview, you can, because I can say that those things really did help me, you know, develop my communication skills, which I did, and my teamwork and whatever. And it just shows that I'm someone that can be responsible.
So a mate of mine went for an interview, and he had a question asked of him, and it was they're quite common in interviews, aren't they? Demonstrate your experience dealing with this sort of situation, type X, or say you had to deal with someone that was upset, or you had to lead a team or something. You can imagine what these questions are like. And they said, well, I don't really know. I've never been in that situation. And then I personally remember being in that scenario and feeling so grateful that I almost had too many opportunities to choose from.
Yeah.
And it wasn't like I took on a hobby like air cadets or you know, school council or whatever, because I thought, you know, when I go for a job interview 10 years down the line, it's going to really come back to me and I'm going to be so grateful. No, you do it and it's fun in the moment, but it does, you do realize in that interview, that moment, how much these things actually contribute to just people's perception of you and what you actually have, you know, what you have done before.
But to be fair, I don't think it's a bad motivation to be like, oh, I'll take this on so that it, you know, helps me in interviews and stuff, because you're still getting an experience out of it. Like, no matter what your intention is, you're getting the same out of it. So I don't think that's a bad reason to take something on like that.
I think definitely play to your hobbies as well, because you'll find it so much easier to commit to something if you enjoy doing it. Air cadets, some people are probably listening right now and thinking, oh, what a loser. Like, he does air cadets, he dresses up in uniform and polishes his shoes and irons his shirts. Great, you know. But like Sam's demonstrated, you might hate all that uniform, drill, marching, whatever, but he likes football, so go out and be a football team captain. And you could probably find any hobby, there'll be a way you can use it to broaden your network. You know, I only heard about Edwards through air cadets.
Yeah. No, yeah, you can just do what you want as well. So, like, I was in a band, so I got to play drums. And yeah, travel to different places, meet different bands, meet different people. And that was great fun.
Yeah. Did you use that in your interview?
I think I have. Yeah. I mean, I always use it in my CV, like my like biggest gig with Neville Staple from the Specials and stuff like that, just to say, like, yeah, that's my little
claim to fame.
I think that's it. Yeah.
See, that's amazing. And that's your own passion as well, isn't it? Like, that's
So that's the thing. It doesn't have to be something academic. It can be anything you want to do.
I have something kind of similar to that. So I raise money by playing golf, which is something I enjoyed to do. So I played 72 holes in a day. So one round is 4 hours. So it was like 16 hours of playing golf, but like, we enjoyed it. We had an absolute laugh and we raised over like £3,000. And obviously the money is amazing. Like, that's going to a great cause, but that has benefited me, because I can use that as say that I've done a charitable thing, and, you know, companies like to see someone that's charitable, because it means that they're going to give their time up to help someone else.
Has anyone got any experience with volunteering that they'd like to share? Any particular anecdotes?
Yeah, I was going to speak about this. When I was, I think I was really young, and the reason I did it was for D of E. I used to volunteer in a charity shop, like, on my high street. And it's so weird, because when I was younger, I had no idea that that would be something that would help me so much. But looking back at it, it gets you exposure to older people, which when you're young, when you're 13, 14, you don't really have, you know, you wouldn't talk to older people apart from your family. But of course, going into work, you're mostly going to be surrounded by older people. So it prepares you for that environment. It gets you working. So understanding, you know, what's required in a business and, you know, what different job roles there are, you know, bits about, like, even stock and stuff like that. That's something that I think, it was really good for me, and it really did help me prepare for work. So even though you're not necessarily getting a monetary value out of it, which I think would make a lot of people turn their nose up at it, it gave me so much experience, you know, so much business experience. I would definitely recommend it to younger people.
I think you mentioned Duke of Edinburgh Award. I think that goes without saying, everyone's heard of it. If you haven't, get in touch with someone at your school or local youth club. Duke of Edinburgh Award, hands down, one of the best things I did. Did anyone else's school do like a trip to maybe a school or an orphanage somewhere that you could take supplies or do some educational experiences with?
We had work experience at our school. Went to school for 2 weeks to primary school. That was fun. I'm sure everyone else has done the same sort of thing. We go out into the world of work for your first time.
People listening to this probably won't be familiar with that experience, because the government cut funding for work experience. I was one of the first years where they stopped it, actually, believe it or not. So my work experience with Edwards, like I say, was through talking to a volunteer, and Edwards then offered it to me after sending off a covering letter and CV.
I did work experience. My school forced me to, but we had a week where we had no lessons and we had to do work experience. If you didn't, you had to come in and just sit there. So that's what they threatened anyway.
There's nothing stopping anyone from reaching out to a local company. If you know there's maybe a fabricators or a engineering firm nearby, give them a phone call. That's probably the best way to get in touch.
I did a talk to a school not long ago in Birmingham, and they were just having their work experience week come up. And my advice to them was make the most out of it, because I've actually done two lots of work experience. And the one was rushed. It was like, that was the one that I had to do. So I got myself a placement at the golf club, actually, which is funny, but I did nothing all week, basically. So it was a waste. It was a complete waste of time. I didn't enjoy it. But then I went back and I went to a company in my half term, and it was Aaron Ellison, who were an electrical wholesaler. So I learned a lot there. So I'd say make the most out of it, because there's no point rushing into a
definitely.
Think about what you might want to do and then actually try it out, because it is really useful.
Like you said, it's relevant. So like the golf club one, you probably would struggle to make the most out of that. I can definitely see the difference in your scenarios there.
I play golf all week.
Yeah, can't complain, can you? My secondary school did a trip to Kenya. Has anyone else got experiences like that? So there's a school known as the Mombasa Freetown School, I believe. And the Friends of Mombasa charity, and I think it was a personal connection that one of our teachers had out there. He had spent a lot of his time connected with his school and organized school trips out there. I think things like that are really useful as well. So, you know, if you can show that you've done the fundraising to pay for your own trip to then go out to a school and then you deliver education or supplies or anything like that, an experience to people abroad, then that's really helpful as well. I went to an orphanage in Peru through the Air Cadet wing that I was a part of. And during my interview here, multiple references to that. They were interested, the interviewers were interested in it. And I think if you're sitting there right now and your school's offering a trip like that, whether or not you're going to get it, you have nothing to lose by applying. Do it. Honestly, you'll have the time of your life if you manage to get out there. Yeah, so talking about hobbies as well, going back to that outside of school, it doesn't even necessarily need to be a club. You'll probably find if you're getting engaged in a hobby and you've got projects maybe you've worked on, so software, you know, if you've programmed, you know, some home automation things, maybe you just had a little play around with some light switches and you've got it hooked up to an Alexa or something.
Building computers.
Yeah. And again, these things benefit you, you know, at the end of the day. When you sit in that interview room, you're a human being interviewed by other human beings. They're not expecting you to say, my entire life I have been preparing for this job interview. You know, it's fun things. What's your hobbies? Because it shows that if this is something you're genuinely interested in doing and you're not just doing it for the sake of doing it, you know, like it's fun things. And they'll be just as excited to talk to you about it, the more interesting your projects probably are. Joe could talk about his piranha gauge.
So yeah, we had to basically have a presentation of a piranha gauge, and I was up at my parents' at the time, and my dad, his garage is just full of so much stuff that I can just grab and play around with, lots of electronic stuff and stuff like that. So I thought I might as well try and build my own one and actually do the presentation around my own little makeshift piranha gauge, which was, using light bulb filaments. So I got some light bulbs, smashed them apart, got the light bulb filaments to use as my piranha filament. I got a saucepan, lined it with rubber gloves to try and get that good seal. and then got put the filament in there, got just a normal Hoover vacuum, and tried to get some different electrical values read on using a multimeter when I turn the vacuum on and turn it off.
I just like the idea of MacGyvering things. How many different
that's basically what it was.
Eastbourne product company things can we make from household items?
I think that, to be fair, I think that's a really good way to draw people in about, because pumps and gauges are really far away from what normal people, you know about, but trying to draw them in by using like real examples.
And it really demonstrates the technology as well. It helped me understand everything that we build.
Yeah, and it shows the thought process was more more in depth than just going, they've asked me to make a presentation, I'm going to go on PowerPoint and make a presentation. That's such an easy conclusion to linear sort of like that. I mean,
I remember driving down from Birmingham with my piece of paper with all the Edwards products and like when it was bought by Atlas Copco and like when it was founded.
Oh,
I was like remembering these facts, and then I got in and they were like, you're playing the sports team. We're like, what's up with that? Nothing to do with the company. Well, no.
Although that doesn't hurt being knowledgeable about a company you're applying for. If you're applying to a company, there's nothing stopping you even getting in touch with the people at the reception desk and saying, are there a couple of people you'd mind scheduling a meeting with me so I could have a phone call? At worst, they say, sorry, we won't let you do that before interviews have happened or before blah, blah, blah.
Yeah,
but at best, you then get to talk to some people that are really knowledgeable about the company and be able to give you a real personal touch on what it's like to work there, what sort of people they expect to work with, and just the general attitude and atmosphere the company has. As I think it doesn't do any harm.
And at worst, it makes you look interested.
I just want to circle back to something which we talked about earlier with work experience, but I just want to clarify because I think it's a really important point, which is that, like, in college, we learned about the hidden job market, which is that apparently only 30% of jobs are actually advertised and are on, you know, stuff like Indeed, whereas 70% of jobs, because companies, if you think about what it takes to advertise a job, you've got to come up, you've got to write the job description, you've got to potentially pay for it to be on job boards, etc., etc. Whereas a lot of companies will have jobs that are technically open for people, but they aren't advertising. And it goes to say that for work experience as well. If you have a local company, or if you know a company that does exactly what you want to do, just email them. And most companies will say, yeah, come in for a week or 2 weeks and we'll give you stuff to look at. We'll show you about the business. And that is, in my opinion, work experience is the best way to prepare for work, because it's literally you're going into the environment that you're going to be working in. Like, what better way is there to do that?
Yeah, and I think that putting them numbers out there, I didn't know the numbers at all, but that's really exaggerates how important it is just to, not even necessarily formally, but informally and casually network with people. You know, someone says, oh, I want to be a software engineer. You think, oh, Google, Facebook, Amazon, who else? Microsoft. You think of all them big names. It's not necessarily going to be listed online that Edwards is looking for software engineers.
So after briefly experiencing some technical, frustrational issues, okay, so we move on to some things to do if you're not certain about what you'll be doing. If you've not got a career in mind, you might be watching this thinking like a degree apprenticeship sounds brilliant, it sounds great. We were just discussing during the break that one thing that we've all had experience with doing at school and also once we started at Edwards were psychometric tests. Some people will be familiar with the Myers-Briggs, what was it? Myers-Briggs test, where you're assigned the four letters. Mixed bag of skepticism there. I'm not going to name any names, but take them all with a pinch of salt. There's more than just that out there. So if you've done one of those and you were unsatisfied with the answers, you can go online and if you type in psychometric careers tests or anything to that effect into your search engine of choice, you will get some handy results. And we were just discussing some of the careers that we were suggested. I was suggested healthcare assistant. John and Joe, would you dare answer what you were told you should do?
Yeah, my top one was a gynecologist, so yeah, that's interesting.
I came out as a dairy farmer, believe it or not.
Are you guys planning on moving towards those careers or
not anytime soon?
I got engineer, so you know, like as we were saying before, sometimes it's accurate, but you've got to take it with a pinch of salt.
And bear in mind, I remember my result as being assigned a healthcare assistant. I was in year 11. I'm now nearly 22. So if you're taking this at a time where you're going through a lot of changes in your life, maybe you've just finished your GCSEs, you're going on to A levels, if you're finishing your A levels, thinking about university, and you've probably you're you've if you're that age, you're probably finishing a lot of clubs. Maybe if you ever did scouts, cadets, football, you're moving into the adult leagues. You'll start to go through big changes in your life, and maybe you will feel a sense of direction. So there's nothing limiting you from taking the test again and again and again. I think, but like Sam said, be aware of your personal bias. You were saying that, you know, answering these tests.
Yeah, so answering these tests, sometimes you might be a bit biased because you might have an idea of where you want to go and they might not be quite as accurate, but you know, that's one thing. But what I wanted to speak about as well, at the very least from doing these tests, it makes you picture yourself doing a job role. So if you get a dairy farmer, for example, you picture yourself there and you think, nah,
yeah. Or you might think, great.
Yeah, you might think great, but it also just inspires you. You can see these long list of careers. I think it gives you a couple. I'm not too sure. I haven't really done one. Yeah. But if you see these careers are out there, you might think of yourself in that career and you might think of giving it a go. And then the next step might be work experience. And then you never know. So at the very least, these things are good at giving you an idea of what sort of roles are out there and what you might want to be going into.
Another concern that I dealt with when thinking about a career to take was I was constantly concerned with pigeonholing myself. There's a little bit of an anecdote here. There's a bloke I know that I worked with when I worked in construction. And if you ever said, oh, I'm thinking of going for a promotion at Air Cadets, you go, oh, you might not want to do that. You want to keep your options open. And he'd say this every time. He says, oh, I'm thinking about applying, going back to college and doing my A levels. He goes, well, before you commit to it, make sure you keep your options open. Try and think about other... And he kept saying, keep your options open. And it's the exact opposite of that. Every time you take on a new experience, you're not holding yourself into saying, oh, you've committed to that track now. You know, I kept thinking, because he kept saying it in that way, I kept thinking, oh, yeah, actually, do I do that? Because if I do that, then I won't be able to take on the other thing. But then you find you've gone for a year, 2 years, and you start to stop committing to things. Because you're like, if I commit to this thing, it will stop me from doing the 7 other things I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. Eventually, it got to a point and I realized I've just got to pick something and commit to it. And I did. And after doing that just a couple of times, I found it wasn't pigeonholing me. It was exposing me. It was briefly, you focus on one thing, you do that for a short period of time, but it exposes you to all these other options out there. You find that where previously you were trying to decide between 7 options, you now got so many more. You've got a plethora of opportunities in front of you because you've experienced that and you've now got a slight proficiency with a new skill, or you're, you know, you start to realize the real nitty gritty behind so like software engineering. You think, oh, it's just programming, you know, I've done a bit of Python, I'll write a few commands, a few functions. There's so much more to that. Since being at Edwards, within the first 3 months, I found out about, you know, cybersecurity, embedded software engineering, that there's so much there. And my one fear coming into this was, am I going to pigeonhole myself to working in an office for the rest of my life? And you think, and coming into this, I thought, how is there any possibility of doing computer science without ending up just sat behind the same desk for the next however many years? But it turns out, you know, there's people that go to fabs out in South Korea and China, and they're walking around with their laptops in other countries, in factories, programming machines. There's people that go over to Ireland to run new software on pumps. It doesn't pigeonhole you at all, you know. So if you've got concerns about your career and you've done these psychometric tests and you've got a vague idea, but you're still not sure what you want to do, and you're scared about committing to, oh, I want to be a, you know, I don't want to end up just doing this one thing the rest of my life. It's not gonna happen, not at this age. Yeah. And if you're the sort of person that can exercise that sort of rational judgment in the first place to consider that as being an option, it at least demonstrates you're self-aware enough to know what your desires really are and how you're going to stay focused on that. In my opinion, I'm not a life coach, but I've got to say from personal experience, it really isn't as daunting as I thought it'd be, having to pick a route for a career.
And it's worth mentioning as well, like, that's a completely valid point, but the fact is that if you go into a job, if you go to uni and you don't like it, just stop doing it and find something else. You know, like, there's nothing, obviously financially that's the kind of thing that's holding us all back from doing whatever we want to do. You know, we have to have a job, we've got to pay our bills, but you know, that there's usually an opportunity for you to be able to switch careers if you want to, or, you know, go and do something else. So you're never pigeonholed, really. You've always got the option to move around.
Especially in this day and age, it's like, yeah. Even if you stick it out and do all of the uni, you can get a degree in electrical engineering and then go work anywhere.
You want, yeah.
It really doesn't, getting the qualifications doesn't mean that you have to stick in that subject, because like, people can go back to uni now at any age and just start again. You know what I mean? It's not the end of the world nowadays, and people do swap job roles all the time, and I think that's how it should be, really, because you want people that enjoy their jobs to be doing those jobs, because they'll be efficient at it. So there should be lots of movement of labour.
Yeah, and I think we've mentioned it before. It's encouraged, isn't it? You know, Edwards is part of the Atlas Copco group, and the internal jobs market is huge, you know. Yeah, brilliant. Again, building on the tools that we were talking about, so there's psychometric testing. Again, if you type that into Google, psychometric careers test, you'll get at least an idea of what the algorithms think you should be doing and what you'll be good at. But there's also other things, so learning styles. I think it's important that we mention that VARK is what it's often known. What's it? Visual, auditory,
reading
and writing.
Reading and kinesthetic. The K is kinesthetic.
Oh, but R stands for reading and writing.
And writing. Oh. Yeah.
Sorry, we didn't think that writing began with K.
The irony is not lost. I thought maybe you thought I had the acronym wrong, but you are right. Reading and writing are very similar. But the point there is just try and do a lot to understand yourself, because in a workplace, it's important that you understand how you're learning, and just adaptations you can do to make your life easier more than anything. If you find that your preferred learning style is kinesthetic, that's, I think, most people would agree, the most challenging learning style, but you can make adaptations to that. Have a squeezy ball on your desk or something you can squeeze while you take in information. You know, there are different learning styles. We aren't all the same.
I was just going to expand on what you were saying about within work. I think that's one difference between school and work, is that in school it's blanket approach. You know, everyone kind of gets treated the same, whereas in work there's a lot more support and leeway in terms of how you do your job, you know. So if you find that your learning style is kinesthetic and you need to be more hands-on, you can speak to your manager, and the chances are that they'll probably be like, yeah, do it more hands-on, then, you know, get a practical setup going.
At school it's so one way, you know. The teacher expects work from you, give it to them, they mark it, they give it back to you. The teacher just keeps giving you work and then giving you feedback, and there's nothing you're really generating. And you work by yourself a lot of the time. You'll be familiar with group projects and that. How often do they come about? Maybe once a year. But day to day, I'm working with, you know, four or five other people. You know, my work, everything is a group task. So people are making it easier for each other as well. That's what I find. So as well as your manager, you know, your colleagues and that can always help you out with adapting to your learning styles.
I'm just sort of circling back to the personality tests and the Myers-Briggs sort of thing. I think it's quite easy to get carried away with that. Whereas understanding your own learning style, I think it's a lot easier and could be a lot more beneficial. So for myself, I'm a kinesthetic learner. I like to do things and repeat them. It's a lot better to understand what sort of learner you are in that respect, because reading from a book, I don't get as much out of it from doing that. If I read the book and then I go and physically do it 10, 15 times, I'm going to understand the process a lot better. But yeah, just from my point of view, it's a lot more important to understand your learning style than sort of what personality you are. I think it has a bigger influence on your work.
As a result of, like, you know, we do all these tests and that, and we do them when we start at work. So we're all quite aware here of what we are and what stage we're at in our careers. And I think we can all agree we're all at varying stages of understanding of our own ability and a skill set we'd take as electrical, mechanical engineers, they're not expecting us to come in professional. It is an apprenticeship. So if that's the route that you guys at home are going to take, don't necessarily come away from an episode like this and think, oh my God, I've never got experience with doing leadership. I must go out and do some experience with that. I don't think I've got much in the way of volunteering. I must go. It's less about what you're doing and what you're capable of, but what your attitude is to approaching these things. You know, it's not got to be a mad rush to the finish line. There isn't a finish line. This is all just an ongoing process of just developing yourself and acknowledging what you are and what stage you're at, and that come across in an interview if you just have a little bit of understanding about what it is you want to get from the apprenticeship, as well as where you currently are, and just a bit of self-understanding, because it goes a long way in the workplace.
I'd like to just say that I feel like we're evaluating ourselves every day with our strengths and weaknesses. So you fail something at work, that doesn't matter, you learn from it. It's really cliche to say that you learn from failures, but obviously you do. And alongside the evaluation, where you realize that maybe we're not the best in this area, we're doing all right in this area, you have meetings with your managers as well, like quite regular, to discuss where you can improve. So we have our goal setting scheme, which is across the whole of Atlas Copco, I think.
Yeah.
So our goals are genuine things that we're trying to work towards, because they're places where we should be improving. And I think that's something that you get out of a degree apprenticeship that is really, really important, compared to if I was just going to university, I wouldn't be evaluating how I work within the workplace. And that is something that hopefully by the end of this degree apprenticeship, I may not be perfect at it, obviously, but I'll understand it and I'll understand where I'm going. And, you know, so that is something that I appreciate from Edwards and the degree apprenticeship as a whole.
So thank you, everyone, for joining in. Thank you, everyone, for coming along and watching. Thank you to Jasmine, Jonathan, Sam, Joe. Thanks for all joining me and discussing our journey into becoming apprentices. And I hope that at least people watching at home, you've got some idea of our experiences and how imperfect the process really is, and that you should sometimes be prepared to just take a commitment to something, and you'll find out what it really, really does for your career. So best of luck, everyone, and see you next time.
Bye. Bye.